Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 23rd May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. Now the link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box and the timestamping of the news articles are also provided in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let us move on to the first news article. Now, this article is about RISAT-2B satellite that was launched by the Indian Space Research Organization yesterday. The article has appeared on left-hand side editorial page in all the editions, page number 10 in Delhi edition and page number 8 in other editions. This will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and in general science. In mains under GS paper 3 in science and technology, indigenization of technology, developing new technology and awareness in the field of space. And according to the author, radar imaging satellite 2B will act as an eye in the sky and hence the title. See, the radar imaging satellite is in news as Indian Space Research Organization has launched the third radar imaging satellite, which is named as RISAT-2B, yesterday, that is May 22, 2019. Earlier, there were two satellites named as radar imaging satellites. They are one RISAT-2 launched in 2009 and the other RISAT-1 launched in the year 2012. After 2012, only in 2019, this year, ISRO has launched another RISAT. And there are series of this radar imaging satellites to be launched in this year and in the coming years. One special thing the article talks about the launch is that the launch was a textbook launch. Here, textbook launch means, you know, the launch of the satellite and the processes associated with the entire flight sequence were as perfect as it was planned without any deviations. All right. And the same kind of word we can also hear from the commentators in cricket, you know, they will say it's a textbook shot. And coming to the article talks about two secondary payloads such as a processor named as Vikram and a micro electro mechanical systems based inertial navigation system. The micro electro mechanical systems is a technology that uses the techniques of micro fabrication involving miniaturized structures, sensors, actuators, and microelectronics to make miniaturized mechanical and electromechanical elements. Inertial navigation system, which is a another secondary payload, was made based on this micro electromechanical system. That's what the article is meaning here. Both the secondary payloads, according to the article, will be helpful for future launches. Note that this year we'll come across the name Vikram with one another mission of ISRO, and that is Chandrayaan 2, where the name of the lander is given as Vikram. And we can see that the satellite is orbiting in space with an inclination of 37 degrees. This is orbital inclination with respect to the equator. See this image, it is the angle between the plane of a orbit and the equator. The angle of orbital inclination is one of the determinants of the orbital path of the satellite and what view it will have on Earth from the orbit. So in order to get frequent observations over the Indian subcontinent, the angle of orbital inclination is kept at 37 degrees. The mission duration of the satellite is 5 years, and it is stated that the launch is to replace radar imaging satellite 2, which was launched 10 years ago, that is in 2009. The satellite will be helpful in enhancing India's capability in crop monitoring during the monsoon season, as during this monsoon season, sky will be overcast with clouds. And this is because RISAT-2B is using microwave radiation and it is not dependent on visible light. Since microwaves have longer wavelength, it will not be influenced by atmospheric scattering and can easily pass through cloud cover, haze and dust, and it can easily image the ground in day or night, even in the presence of cloud cover. In the case of optical remote sensing satellite, these observations are not possible as it is dependent on visible light. Instead of having passive microwave sensors that detect the radiation naturally or reflected by objects on the ground, RISAT-2B will transmit microwave pulses to the ground, and using radar, it will receive the signals that are reflected by the objects. Now, while the strength of the reflected signal will help in determining different targets, the moisture and texture of the object will determine the strength of the microwave signal that gets reflected from the object, which is on the Earth's surface. See, the time between the transmitted and reflected signals is helpful in determining the distance to the object. See, the another feature of the satellite is that it uses X-band synthetic aperture radar. Now, this X-band is known for higher resolution imagery for target identification and discrimination in comparison with C-band that was used in RISAT-1 launched in the year 2012. So, whenever we refer to those pictures taken by the satellites, we should not say it as satellite images, we refer them as satellite imagery. And this X-band helps to study small objects with dimensions of even 1 meter and also their movements, which helps in surveillance. And the mission also has advanced radial rib unfurlable antenna. And this was developed indigenously by ISRO in just in a record time of 13 months. If this was not developed by ISRO, then we should be dependent on imports. But this would have delayed the entire launch of this RISAT-2B satellite to 2023 or even 2024. Now, with the deployment of this antenna in the orbit, ISRO has demonstrated the world-class technology in orbit. Coming to the main applications of this radar imaging satellite, you know, it will be realized in crop monitoring in agriculture, monitoring of forest fires and deforestation in forestry, flood mapping in national disaster management, surveillance and monitoring for both civil and military purposes. Note that this RISAT-2 capital B is the first in the RISAT-2B series. More satellites, you know, RISAT-2BR1, RISAT-2BR2 are to be launched in this year or next year by ISRO. This satellite launch, this RISAT-2B launch, is the third launch by ISRO this year, and ISRO is gearing up for Chandrayaan-2 launch that was scheduled in July this year. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. With this, let's move on to the analysis of next news article. The next news article is regarding non-banking financial companies or NBFCs. See, this article has appeared on page 13 in Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions, and in page 15 of Delhi edition. Now, this article will be relevant in prelims under current events of national importance and under economic development. The analysis will be also relevant in your mains preparation under GS3 in Indian economy. The news article discusses about the present liquidity crisis in NBFCs and how it is affecting them and also others. Here, liquidity crisis means the financial crunch or money shortage that the non-banking financial companies are facing. This article states that the current liquidity crisis in NBFC sector may not pose a systemic risk for now, but the investors are worried over its potential impact on the overall growth of the economy in the near term. Here, systemic risk means the risk to the entire financial system within India. In this context, let us see about this non-banking financial companies. See, the non-banking financial companies are those companies that are registered under Companies Act of 1956 and engaging in any of the businesses such as loans and advances, acquisition of securities market like securities, shares, stocks, bonds and debentures. NBFCs can also perform insurance business, chit business and also leasing business. If you see, NBFCs lend and also make investments, and hence their activities are similar to that of banks. However, there are few differences between NBFCs and banks. Firstly, NBFC cannot accept demand deposits, whereas a bank can accept demand deposits. Next, NBFCs do not form a part of the payment and settlement system, but banks form a part of payment and settlement system. Payment and settlement system means the banking transactions that happen within a country. See, this system, this payment and settlement system consists of all type of arrangements that are used to systematically transfer money, which can be in the form of currency or paper instruments such as checks, and also various electronic channels. So NBFCs cannot issue checks drawn on itself, whereas a bank can issue checks. And finally, the deposit insurance facility of Deposit Insurance and Credit Guarantee Corporation is not available to the depositors of NBFCs, whereas the same deposit insurance facility is available to the banks. Now, you also need to know that NBFCs are not completely regulated by one single body, since different kinds of NBFCs exist for different purposes. So they are regulated by different agencies accordingly. If you see, majority of the non-banking financial companies are regulated by Reserve Bank of India. And NBFCs specializing in venture capital and stock broking are regulated by Securities and Exchange Board of India. We saw that NBFCs can also involve in insurance business. These companies are regulated by IRDAI, that is Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India. Know that NIDHI companies are regulated by Ministry of Corporate Affairs of Government of India. See, the core business of NIDHI companies is borrowing and lending activity between its members. Now, we also saw that NBFCs are also involved in chit fund business. Now, this is regulated by respective state governments only within their state jurisdiction. So, different agencies exist for regulating different kinds of NBFCs. Next, we shall see about different categories of NBFCs based on different criteria. See, you can classify NBFCs in terms of liabilities into two types, as deposit accepting NBFCs and NBFCs that do not accept deposits. In terms of size, you can classify NBFCs into two, you know, as systemically important NBFCs and other non-deposit holding companies. Here, know that systemically important NBFCs means companies with an asset value of more than 500 crores. So if systemically important NBFCs fail, the financial system will come under pressure. Next, in terms of the kind of activity these companies conduct, based on that, it can be classified into 10 types. It may be difficult to remember all the 10 types. Just try to know few important types such as asset finance company and infrastructure finance company. So we can see that the functioning of NBFCs is a lesser part when compared to the banking system in India. Now let us come to the news article. A report released by one of the non-banking financial companies say that high risk aversion, delayed monetary transmission, and subdued mutual fund flows could result in a further slowing of this NBFC sector. High risk aversion means the investors in NBFCs preferring to invest in low-risk stocks that give low returns rather than investing in high-risk stocks that give high returns due to the present liquidity crisis that is happening in the NBFC sector. Delayed monetary transmission means the delayed effect of the price change implementation in NBFC sector after the policy is announced by the regulators. Subdued mutual fund flows mean the reduced mutual fund flows at present. So all these three factors are likely to slow the already slowing NBFC sector. Now, this report also tells that the large NBFCs with strong parent companies and track records can manage the present liquidity crisis. But the small NBFCs could lose their market share, leading to a sharper slowdown, especially in the case of mid-sized and small housing finance companies. The next news article is about Masood Azhar and China. This article appears on page number 9 in Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram edition and 11 in Delhi edition. This article will be relevant in prelims and current events of national and international importance, and in mains in GS paper 2, India and its neighborhood, regional global groupings, agreements involving India and or affecting India's interests, and also includes bilateral and bilateral agreements. Masood Azhar was listed as a global terrorist on May 1 by the 1267 Committee of United Nations Security Council after China withdrew its hold. The author has discussed this shift in China's position in this editorial. He has given four reasons which could have led the possible shift in China's position. The first reason is the changing geostrategic dynamics in the Indo-Pacific region. The United States-China trade tensions are at its peak now. The author feels that China's continued support for Azar would have made India to move more closer to the United States in this changing geostrategic dynamic. The second reason given by the author is that the escalation by the United States regarding Azar's matter in the United Nations Security Council, which could have compelled China to openly provide convincing reasons for its stand for listing this Masood Azhar. US escalated the matter by circulating draft resolution among the United Nations Security Council members so that a voting may be conducted whether to list Azhar as global terrorist, not in 1267 committee, but within United Nations Security Council, including the 15 members. But what could have happened? China thought if such a voting happened, China would not have much partners to support it in the voting process, which may end like 14 people to support listing of Azhar and only China, which is acting against it. In order to avoid this, and because of the escalation by the United States, China could have withdraw its hold in listing Masood Azhar as a global terrorist. Now, the third reason the author gives is, instead of letting the United States, France and the United Kingdom to take credit for helping India in listing Masood Azhar, China would have seen merit in reassuring India by withdrawing the hold. Along with this, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor and India's membership of the Nuclear Suppliers Group has emerged as a major issue in the bilateral ties of India and China. Finally, the author is telling that China is projecting its major power diplomacy through initiatives such as Belt and Road Initiative and through its commitment to fight global terror. If China has supported Azhar, then China would have been seen as working against its commitment to fight the global terror. So China might have supported Azhar. The author also tells that by supporting India in designating Azhar as a global terrorist, it would also expect the same support from India in the form of supporting the BRI initiative. The author has shared his views on India, China and Pakistan in this editorial. And first, let us see the views on China. The author tells that China's withdrawal of hold will pave way for enhancing ties between India and China in the proposed or yet to happen second Wuhan summit. The author is also cautious of the fact that all these actions of China to pacify India is not going to change China's stand on Pakistan, since Pakistan is an all-time friend of China. Now, this was reiterated by Chinese president in his recent meeting with Pakistan Prime Minister in the sidelines of Belt and Road Initiative conference in Beijing. The author also mentions the timing at which China withdraw its hold. He tells that China has cleverly avoided the impression of aiding BJP's electoral prospects by removing the hold in listing Masood Azhar during the election time, not before the elections. Let's see the author's view on Pakistan now. He tells that Pakistan is most unlikely to bring Masood Azhar to justice for the actions he has done against India and against other countries. Now, this is similar to the case of Hafiz Saeed of Lashkar-e-Taiba. The author also tells that Pakistan will ensure that Masood Azhar remains safe and be capable of organizing attacks against India. Now, coming to the comments and suggestions to India, he tells that India should sustain the pressure on Pakistan to take conclusive action against terror outfits operating from the Pakistani soil. And he discusses about China's changed position, such as, you know, China condemning the Pulwama terrorist attack, and China has also cooperated at the Financial Action Task Force session in Paris in ensuring that Pakistan remains on the grey list. And also, more importantly, China has not reacted to India's preemptive strikes on Pakistan. Next, the author tells that India and China are closely engaged after the Wuhan summit. The author stresses that the same spirit should continue in the yet to come or proposed second Wuhan summit as well. Finally, you know, there is a need for a well-structured India-China dialogue on regional and global terrorism. This dialogue is needed so that India can convince China to sustain pressure on Pakistan to act against terrorists And this should happen also in the interest of the entire global community. Now, this article is regarding Shanghai Cooperation Organization, shortly called as SCO. See, this article appears in page number 11 in Chennai, Bengaluru, Thiruvananthapuram editions, and 13 in Delhi. It will be relevant in current events of international and national importance in prelims and in GS paper 2 under bilateral, regional, global groupings involving India or affecting India's interests, and under important international institutions, their structure and mandate. Now, the news is that the External Affairs Minister of India has urged member nations of Shanghai Cooperation Organization for greater counter-terror cooperation. She has quoted the recent IS attacks in Sri Lanka, the Islamic State, and also the Pulwama terror strike. The minister said that India remain committed to the regional connectivity and also committed to the peace in the country of Afghanistan. And India is open to strengthening the regional anti-terror structure, or RATS, of this Shanghai Cooperation Organization to fight terrorism and security challenges in the region. Now let us see about this Shanghai Cooperation Organization. See, it was founded in the year 2001 by 5 countries. These 5 countries are called as founding members. So if a group of countries form an organization, they become the founding members of that organization. And those countries who join the organization later are just called as members, not called as founding members. So know the difference between a founding member and a member. Now, the founding members of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization are China, Russia, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyz Republic. India and Pakistan became the members in the year 2017. And Shanghai Cooperation Organization also has 4 countries as observer states and 6 countries as dialogue partners. See, observer states are those nations that are invited by some organization to take part in their organization's activities. These countries just observe the ongoing activities of the organization which invited them and will not take part in the roles that are played by the member countries. And dialogue partner means those who engage in dialogue for a particular sector of common interest based on the invite from the organization, right? Now, coming to the goals of this Shanghai Cooperation Organization, first, to strengthen mutual trust and neighborliness among the member states of Shanghai Cooperation Organization. You take most of the regional organizations, this will be the one of the goals of the organization. That is to strengthen mutual trust and neighborliness. Next, to promote the effective cooperation of the member states in various areas such as politics, trade, culture, environmental protection, and other areas as well. And also to make joint efforts to maintain and ensure peace, security and stability in the region. And there are 2 permanent bodies. This is where you have to keep attention. See, one is the Shanghai Cooperation Organization Secretariat. Now, the Secretariat is located in Beijing, the capital of China. And the second permanent body is the Executive Committee for the Regional Anti-Terrorist Structure, in short called as RATS. The main aim of this RATS is to promote the cooperation of the member states of SCO against 3 evils, which are terrorism, separatism, and extremism, right? And know that the headquarters of this RATS is at Tashkent, which is the capital of Uzbekistan. And one more additional news is that the peace mission exercise 2018 of Shanghai Cooperation Organization was conducted in Russia. And this year, it was planned to conduct Sariarka Anti-Terror Exercise 2019, which is a joint anti-terrorism exercise. Now, the displayed prelims question will be discussed in the final session. Now, let us move on to the next news article. Now, this article is about repatriation of Rohingya refugees, and it appears on page number 9 in Chennai, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions, and page number 11 in Delhi edition. The discussion based on this article will be relevant in main syllabus under GS2 in India and its neighborhood relations, and in bilateral, regional, global groupings and agreements involving India and affecting India's interests, and also effects of policies and politics of developed and developing countries on India's interests. The author first discusses the background for the refugee crisis. So let us first understand the background. See, the Rohingyas are an ethnic Muslim minority of Myanmar. Even though an estimated 35 lakh members of Rohingya community are dispersed worldwide. See, before August 2017, around 10 lakh Rohingya Muslims resided in the Rakhine state of Myanmar. In the Rakhine state itself, they accounted for nearly one third of the population. Here you should note that Buddhists are the Myanmar's dominant group or majority, and Rohingyas differ ethnically or linguistically and even religiously from the Buddhist communities. The Rohingyas trace their origin in Myanmar to the 15th century when thousands of Muslims came to former Arakan Kingdom of Myanmar. More Rohingyas arrived during the 19th and early 20th centuries when Rakhine was governed under colonial rule as part of British India. But successive governments since the independence of Myanmar in 1948 have refuted or rejected the historical claims of Rohingyas that they belong to the country. So the government denied them the official ethnic group recognition, and this non-recognition is also because the Rohingyas are considered as illegal immigrants from Bangladesh. Further, the government refuses to grant them citizenship, and as a result, most of the group's members have no legal documents, and this makes them effectively stateless. Stateless means a person or individual who does not have a nationality of any country. Until recently, the Rohingya had been able to register at least as a temporary residence with identification cards, which are known as white cards. These white cards or these identification cards conferred them with limited rights, but they were not recognized as a proof of citizenship. But it provided some kind of recognition of, you know, temporary stay for the Rohingya in Myanmar. But under pressure from Buddhist nationalists, the then president of Myanmar cancelled this temporary identity cards or these white cards in February 2015, which also revoked their right to vote. Earlier, see, these white card holders were also allowed to vote. Now note that earlier they were just fighting for their rights within Myanmar, but now they are fleeing the country. Now, the major reasons for Rohingyas fleeing the country was poverty, discriminations such as, you know, restrictions on marriage, family planning, employment, restrictions on education, restrictions with respect to religious choice, discrimination with respect to all these religious choice, education, freedom of movement, and lack of employment opportunities in the state of Rakhine. But note that the reason for the recent runaway or the recent fleeing in 2017 was different. A militant group known as Arakan Rohingya Salvation Army claimed responsibility for attacks on police and army posts in August 2017. So what did the Myanmar government do? The Myanmar government declared this Arakan Rohingya Salvation Army as a terrorist organization. Now what followed that was the most brutal thing. See, additionally, the military of Myanmar mounted brutal attack on Rohingya villages, and they forced nearly 7 lakh Rohingyas to leave Myanmar. When this brutal attack was mounted on Rohingyas, in the very first month of attack, in the year 2017 itself, around 6,000 people were killed. And it was also alleged that Myanmar's security forces opened fire on fleeing civilians and also planted landmines near border crossings, which was the border crossings were used by Rohingyas to flee to Bangladesh. Note that these landmines are explosive mines that are laid under the ground surface. And the United Nations Secretary General has called this violence as ethnic cleansing. Rights groups and other UN leaders also suspected that acts of genocide have taken place. And Human Rights Agency said that thousands were killed and sexual assault, was used as a weapon of war, and villages were burned to the ground. And an independent investigation was carried out by United Nations, which decided that Myanmar's military chief and other leaders should be investigated and prosecuted for genocide and crimes against humanity.
They had evidences, you know, though all the evidences are, you know, overwhelmingly sufficient, Myanmar's leaders refuse to accept such allegations. Now, because of the violence conducted against these Rohingya Muslim community, they fled to the nearby countries such as Bangladesh, Malaysia, Thailand, etc. But the majority of them went to Bangladesh. So, as a result, Bangladesh is struggling with the influx of Rohingya refugees. But Bangladesh authorities often say that if improved and comfortable conditions are provided to the refugees, it could act in two ways. One, it will serve as a pull factor for other refugees also. And two, those who are already in the country as refugees will not leave the country because of the improved and comfortable conditions within Bangladesh. Therefore, Bangladesh sought to block services or not to accept services from international humanitarian groups. But this was changed later because of the increase in public pressure that happened when a mass influx of refugees began in August 2017. Here you have to note that initially Bangladesh thought Rohingya would be short-term guests. But now the situation has worsened for Bangladesh as Myanmar is not at all cooperating to take Rohingyas back even after 2 years. And this is because there are 12 lakh refugees and they are overcrowded into refugee camps, you know, without freedom of movement and with restrictions on rights to obtain employment, education and other social services. In November 2017, because of pressure from China, Bangladesh and Myanmar signed an agreement to repatriate refugees. When we mean repatriation, we mean sending the person back to their own country. But what happened after the agreement between this Bangladesh and Myanmar, the attempt to repatriate the refugees failed. The reason was, you know, not even a single Rohingya volunteered to return to Rakhine because they think that there is absence of conducive or there is no conducive or favorable environment in Myanmar and they fear that they will be placed in detention camps in Myanmar also. Now in 2019, nearly 2 years after they fled Myanmar, Rohingya refugees in Bangladesh have been provided with identity cards. This is provided by Bangladesh government and the United Nations High Commission for Refugees. It has been given to safeguard their right to voluntarily return to their home, that is to Myanmar, and to assist in such procedures. Now, the author states that it is likely that Myanmar will agree to create an environment for safe and voluntary return of Rohingyas back to their country. This is because if they don't create the environment for safe and voluntary return, this act of being continuous defiance or resistant will have high cost for Myanmar to bear. That is, there will definitely be punitive action for the violence that took place in 2017 with respect to Rohingya Muslim community. Because so far China and Russia, who are the veto-wielding members of UN Security Council, have blocked action against Myanmar at the UN Security Council. Otherwise, these actions would have been already taken against Myanmar. Now, what are the blocked actions? See, these blocked actions are referring to the International Criminal Court, are targeted sanctions, you know, making sanctions on Myanmar, and even a global arms embargo. Here the ICC referral or referring to ICC is whenever genocide, crimes against humanity or war crimes are happening or committed, these crimes are referred to ICC prosecutor by UN Security Council. And then ICC would conduct the inquiry which may result in serious punitive actions. Arms embargo means official ban on trade of arms with a particular country and Myanmar will suffer because of that. But these actions are blocked because of Russia and China. Then the author adds that in this situation, India should be a force for positive change and should join the international community to insist that Myanmar should protect the Rohingyas' rights and ensure their safe return. Thus, we come to the end of this discussion. Next, we'll move on to the practice question discussion session. Now, the first question. Now, the question is with respect to RISAT-2B satellite. They have given two statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. See, the first statement, the radar imaging Earth observation satellite 2B has enhanced ability with respect to monitoring and surveillance in night and during overcast sky as it is using microwave radiation as transmitting and receiving signals. Now, this statement is correct. We discussed during our analysis that the optical remote sensing satellites depend on visible light, rather, whereas this RISAT-2B depend on microwave radiation. Therefore, it is easy, and this radiation could penetrate even cloudy sky, etc. So the first statement is correct, and that really enhances the monitoring and surveillance, particularly in night, and therefore it's particularly in night, and therefore it is also called as all-weather observation satellite also. Now the second statement, the RISAT-2B is the first radar imaging satellite sent to space by Indian Space Research Organization. Now RISAT-2B is the first in the RISAT-2B series, not the first radar imaging satellite sent to space, because we already have two satellites that were sent in the year 2009 and 2012. RISAT-2 was sent in 2009 and RISAT-1 was sent in 2012. And after a span of around 7 years, now the third satellite, you know, RISAT-2B was launched yesterday. So the second statement is wrong. Therefore, the correct answer for this question is option A, one only. Now, the second question is with respect to non-banking financial companies. There are different types of non-banking financial companies that exist in India. At present, they are regulated by which of the following? RBI, SEBI, NABARD, state governments. Today we saw that there are different kinds of non-banking financial companies, and they carry out different functions. And therefore, based on the function, the regulatory body for the particular NBFCs, they also differ. Maybe for example, like if an NBFC is dealing with the loans, it might be regulated by RBI. If they deal with securities, stocks, it will be dealt by SEBI or Securities and Exchange Board of India. Similarly, state governments are also regulatory body for certain types of non-banking financial companies. So the correct answer, but not NABARD. Except for NABARD, the RBI, SEBI and state government will play some kind of regulatory activity with respect to non-banking financial companies. And therefore, the correct answer for this question is option D, 1, 2 and 4. The third question is with respect to the discussion related to Shanghai Cooperation Organization, wherein we discussed two permanent bodies of the organization. One is the secretariat, which is located in the capital of China, and the other is the regional anti-terrorism structure, or shortly called as RATS. Now they are asking, regional anti-terrorist structure is a permanent body of which of the following? It's a very straightforward question. Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Note that the main aim of this RATS is to promote the cooperation of the member states of Shanghai Cooperation Organization against terrorism, separatism and extremism. With this, we come to the end of today's news analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, share, comment and subscribe to our Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for daily updates of news analysis.